So today, so first of all, to introduce myself, my name's Chris Harmon. I'm a professor in the chemistry department here at HSU, one of the co-organizers of this event. We've been doing this now for almost 6 years, so put your hands together for Science on Tap. So I'm here to introduce Dr. Lucy Kerhoulas. I got it right. Okay, good. Okay, so Dr. Kerhoulas received her BS in Botany in 2006 from HSU. How about that? She also received her master's degree from HSU in 2008 from somebody who I think is sitting here in the room somewhere. I don't think so. From Steve Sillett. In 2013, she received her PhD in Forest Ecophysiology from NAU, Northern Arizona University of Flagstaff, the other lumberjacks. I do not know that. That's a college trivia. So she came here as a lecturer in the forestry and biology departments in 2013, and she's taught a variety of courses, and we are very lucky to have her as a full-time tenure line faculty member starting in fall 2016. She has research interests including forest water use, drought stress, responses to management, canopy ecology, and something I'm really excited about, her work in stable isotopes. Chemistry permeates all of the sciences. Okay, so without further ado, please put your hands together for Dr. Kerhoulas.
Well, thank you guys for coming out to drink beer and talk about science. This is really fun. So as Chris introduced, I'm Lucy, and today, yeah, how's the volume?
Louder.
Is it good? Louder?
Yeah.
A little bit louder? Okay, so there's a little bit louder. All right, so today I'm going to be talking to you about some of the work that I've been doing in tall Sitka spruce trees here on the North Coast. So a topic that's near and dear to my heart. So before I get going too much, I did want to thank, before I forget, by the end of the talk, my collaborators and my funders. So Nick Kerhoulas up there in the upper left, he's my husband and number one field assistant. And then Wade Polda here in the middle, he's my number two field assistant. And those two guys, this lately, have been spending more time in the tree than me. So they've been super helpful. And then also my mentor and colleague, Steve Sillett, who kind of, when I was talking about wanting to get into Sitka spruce research, he said, oh, you gotta use these pumpkins, these big trees here. So he knew where all the big ones were. So thanks, Steve, for all that. And then also the forestry department at HSU has been super supportive, and I've been happy to be working there. And Save the Redwoods League funded all this research. So I wanted to give the Redwoods League a shout out. All right. And then Millie McCord, she's been super helpful in the lab, helping to identify all the epiphytes, lots of time with the microscopes and little chemical tests. And then Marie Antoine has also been really helpful with epiphyte ID. All right. So I broke my talk up into three kind of acts, and they're in decreasing length because I figure your attention span will be starting to fade. So the first act will be kind of the meatiest, and then they'll kind of chill out a little bit. And we can have beer breaks in between acts. So the first act here is, it's complicated being tall. So living around here on the North Coast, we all are well aware of the fact that there's tall trees, right? So where we live, you know, we have a number of tree species that are over 300 feet tall. You know, there's redwood, there's Douglas fir, and there's Sitka spruce. Western hemlocks can get pretty tall too. So we live among the giants. And so we're all well aware of that. It might even be why you came to Humboldt. But what you might not be so aware of is that in tall trees, there's a really big gradient in leaf morphology. So redwood, the coast redwood around here, is sort of the champion in this morphology gradient with their foliage. So shown here on the left are redwood leaves from the base of the live crown of a tall tree, and they're really expanded and familiar looking. This is probably what you see on the forest floor walking in the Arcata Community Forest. on the right here are leaves from the tall treetops, so maybe 110 meters or so. And they look really, really different. Every semester when I teach dendrology, I usually have some innocent student that comes to my office, you know, is like, oh my gosh, I found giant sequoia in the Arctic community forest kind of thing. And I'm like, no, it's just the treetop foliage from redwood, post-redwood. And so I brought here some props for tonight. We'll see how this goes. So here I've got base of life crown foliage, and then so this stuff here really expanded. I'll pass them around. A lot to manage here. And then here's some treetop foliage, just so you can up close and personal kind of take a peek at it. And they're labeled in case you get confused. So what you might not, so yeah, obviously their morphology is really different in foliage from different areas in the tree crown, but if you're into plants and you're into physiology, the next logical question is, well, okay, big whoop, like they look different, but do they function differently? Like, is their physiology different? There's sure enough, their physiology probably does differ. But before you're wondering about the physiology, another question you might be wondering is, what's driving this? Like, why do these look so different, right? And so there's two main reasons. The first one is pretty obvious, is light availability. So sure enough, as you go from the treetop to the base of the live crown in a tall tree, light availability is gonna decrease exponentially. And so yeah, this is gonna have a really big effect on how leaves look. Leaves that develop under high light are gonna be reduced compared to leaves that develop under the shade, which try to maximize their surface area to collect as much sun as possible. So we've got light factoring into the situation. But there's another factor too that's been shown to be driving this gross difference in morphology. And that is tree hydraulics. So what's shown here, and this was a 2004 paper put out by George Koch in Nature, and he was my PhD advisor, and Steve Sillett working in tall redwood trees. And what they showed is here's height above ground on the x-axis, so from the base of the live crown all the way to the treetops over here. And then on the vertical axis is xylem pressure, or water potential. And basically, what this is showing is that as you go up the tree, the water potential decreases. So the more negative the number, the more kind of water stressy it is. So inherently, treetop foliage is more water stressed than base of live crown foliage. And this makes it hard for cells to maintain turgor. If the water column in the tree is under a lot of tension, it's hard for cells to expand. And so you have these really compact, dense cells in the leaves, and it's hard for the leaves to fully expand. So we see this difference in morphology. So that's what that graph is showing. Oh yes, and so this trend is the gravitational pressure gradient, GPG. And basically what that is that for every meter of height increase in a tree, that the tree has to draw water up against gravity, the water potential will decrease, become more stressed, by about negative 0.01 megapascals. So what that means is that at 100 meters in a tall tree, the most relaxed that water potential could possibly be on like the best day ever would be negative 1 megapascals, which is substantial. That's just due to gravity alone, not to be scoffed at. And so that's why we see this linear trend here, water potential decreasing about 0.01 megapascals per meter. And so sure enough, in this 2004 Nature paper, they showed that, yeah, this actually does affect physiology in these plants. So we see here, again, here's height going from the base of live crown to the treetop on the x-axis. And then on the vertical axis, we have maximum photosynthetic capacity. And you can see that it's decreasing pretty substantially with height. And this is, you might be thinking, okay, yeah, so what? But this is really surprising given that the treetop foliage is sun foliage, there's sun leaves, and the base of the live crown foliage with the higher photosynthetic capacity, those are shade leaves, leaves that developed in the shade. And if you kind of are familiar at all with plant physiology, sun leaves should have a more superstar kind of photosynthetic capacity compared to shade leaves. They should be chock full of photosynthetic pigments, and they should be able to rock out, so to speak. But we don't see that. And so another thing to kind of bear in mind is that these measurements were made on what we call cut hydros. So you go up into the tree and you cut some branches, usually about a centimeter in diameter, so little sprigs. And then you rappel down in the tree and you have a 5 gallon bucket of water waiting, and you recut the stem underwater. So when you make your first cut, the water in that plant recoils because the water's under tension. So picture a rubber band snapping. And so if you recut that sprig underwater, taking off the air space in the stem, you can kind of reconnect its hydraulic system. And so if we do that and then let the sprigs kind of recalibrate to water, and then you can measure them on this beast called the Lake Horse 6400. So here it is, a two-year-old can operate it. So here's the Lake Horse 6400, and then here, is a cut hydro. So I have a little tube of water here, and then some Sitka spruce foliage from some height, right? And so this foliage is completely relaxed of the normal water tension that it would be experiencing in the tree. So in situ, in the tree, it's even more water stress. But if we completely relax it from its in situ water stress due to gravity and look at what it's made of, like show me what you got kind of thing when I put you in the light core, the treetop foliage cannot like hang tough essentially with the base of lead crown foliage, which is really surprising. And it's largely due to, well, it's sort of a mystery. It leads to some head scratching. If these are sun leaves and they should be able to photosynthesize, you know, way more than the shade leaves, what's going on here? And so we have to think about leaf anatomy a little bit. So we see we're passing around the different foliage and how they look morphologically, but if we think about the leaf anatomy that goes with those different morphologies, there's some pretty drastic differences. So here is a cross-section of a leaf from the base of the live crown around 50 meters. This is in redwood. And you can see that there's tons of airspace throughout the leaf, right? And now if we look at a cross-section of a leaf from a treetop from 110 meters, you can see how densely packed this mesophyll of the cell is. It's basically pure cells. And so this might influence photosynthesis, right? Like this difference in leaf anatomy, they're pretty different drastically. So it may have been a while since you thought about deep thoughts with photosynthesis. So just to recap here, so you have a leaf, right? And it's gonna make sugar. And how it's gonna do that is it uses water, and then it uses sunlight energy, and really importantly, it uses carbon dioxide. So carbon dioxide has got to get to the sites of photosynthesis. It's gotta make it to rubisco, this enzyme that's gonna fix it into a sugar, essentially. And so if we think about those different leaf anatomies and the long, arduous journey of a CO2 molecule from the atmosphere to rubisco nestled inside the chloroplast, that can be a pretty long, drawn-out path. So it's a very cruisy, kind of easy path in the 50-meter leaf, right? There's lots of airspace to zip through as a CO2 molecule, versus in this really densely packed mesophyll, that's pretty much all cells that the CO2 molecule has to make its way through. And CO2 diffuses 10,000 times more slowly through liquid than it does through air. So this can be a pretty darn limiting situation as far as rubisco getting sufficient CO2 to be making sugars. So this is kind of one piece of the puzzle of, well, why do these leaves with really different morphologies, why do they have different physiologies? And so sure enough, when we crunch the numbers and get the data, if we look at respiration rate, so this is respiration rate on the vertical axis, and this is height on the horizontal axis, and you can see that respiration rates significantly increase with height. So largely, if you think about all of these cells are respiring, they all have mitochondria. This is a way more expensive leaf to maintain for the plant compared to that. That's cheap. This is really expensive and a total investment. So it has a higher respiration rate. So we see that here. This was some of my master's work. And then also what we see in this treetop foliage is that CO2 internal conductance, so how CO2 is moving from the substomatal chamber through the mesophyll of the leaf to the sites of photosynthesis, that is decreasing with height in tall trees. So we think that those two things, increased respiration rates and decreased internal CO2 conductance through those treetop leaves, is probably what's behind the observed decrease in photosynthesis in treetop foliage. And this is kind of something to ponder, because this could be one of the things that kind of limits how tall trees can grow, right? The higher up you go, you're under further and further gravitational constraints in your leaf morphology and anatomy and physiology. There might be kind of a limit to how tall trees can grow physiologically. And so sure enough, if we look at then the influence of internal CO2 conductance against photosynthesis, you can see that it's a really nice tight relationship. So this internal CO2 conductance, how effective CO2 is at moving through leaves, has a really quite substantial influence on a leaf's photosynthetic capacity. All right. So that was all work that was done in redwood, because redwood is this like mega charismatic tree, right? Everybody loves redwood. And Sitka spruce is another conifer in our neck of the woods that you might not be so much quite on your radar. So Sitka spruce is the third tallest conifer species in the world. So we got redwood, we got Doug fir, and then Sitka spruce. They grow over 300 feet tall, and they're really beautiful trees. Here is, and it's kind of washed out, the picture, but there you can see for scale, there's a nick in the tree, in one of our study trees. And some other things about Sitka spruce, I'm just on the Sitka spruce, let's hear it for Sitka spruce. I often think of it as the party tree, because first of all, its early leaves are often used for seasonal beers. And it's wood, of all softwoods in the world, it's wood has the highest strength to weight ratio. And so in World War II, it was used for a lot of like bomber planes and stuff. It was a popular wood for planes and boats. And then it's because of its high strength to weight ratio, it resonates really well. And so it's often used for a lot of like musical instruments. So music, beer, tall trees, it's a good one. All right, so that's Sitka spruce. here we're sort of at the southern end of its range. It's a coastal species ranging from around Fort Bragg all the way up into Alaska, kind of hugging the coast. So we're at the kind of tail end of its distribution here on the north coast. All right, so the weird thing about Sitka spruce, which kind of caught my attention after having worked with redwood and looking at leaf morphology and leaf physiology, is that Sitka spruce really does not show this, even though it grows to be over 300 feet tall, it's a bit of an enigma, because it doesn't have this really big morphology gradient that we see in some of the other tall conifers. So here's redwood just for comparison, looking at the shoot mass to area ratio, so like a metric to look at kind of that change in morphology. And you can see it's really steep, like on the vertical axis, it's ranging from 100 to 700. And then if we look at Sitka spruce in comparison, the same kind of range of height, so up to about 90 meters here, the vertical axis, there's barely any spread. So Sitka spruce really doesn't show this gross difference in morphology, even though it's super tall. So immediately that was kind of like an eye catcher. What's up with this tall conifer? So it has a relatively weak leaf mass to area gradient. And so that led to some head scratching. And so that is the end of my first act. And I wanted to kind of, so we're gonna be pondering while you have some sips of beer about like what could be, why could in Sitka spruce there be such little variation in morphology with height. Is there any questions so far on act one before we take a break? Yeah.
What about Doug fir?
Doug fir, it has a leaf morphology gradient.
More like redwood?
It's not as pronounced as redwood, but it's more pronounced than the Sitka spruce. Good question. Yeah.
So I'm a little curious, growth of the redwoods and other trees, does it slow as it gets mature?
Uh, yeah, so height growth does change. It depends, like, growth is kind of a vague term, you know? I mean, yeah, the tree's growing, but it depends a little bit, like, what metric of growth you're looking at. So height growth usually decreases as trees age and get bigger. So, like, how many centimeters per year are they putting on as far as height growth? And radial growth, like, if you just look at tree ring width, usually decreases as trees get bigger, largely due to just the circumference, kind of like the geometry of putting on concentric rings as the tree gets bigger. But volumetric growth has been shown to be increasing as trees get bigger. So if you look at the whole tree level, the growth is actually increasing as the trees age and grow bigger. Yeah.
I heard redwoods get a lot of their water from the fog, and I was wondering how that played into it, into the shape of the leaves and the morphology of it. As opposed to, like, are some more specialized for water uptake versus versus photosynthesis, right, getting sunlight?
Yeah, that's a really, really good question. So, yes, and I'm going to talk about this in Act 2.
Oh, cool.
I think Act 2. But, yeah, so redwood has been shown that it can foliarly, like, through the stomatal pores in the leaves, it can absorb fog water. And so it could be, as the sprigs are going around, you'll notice that on the treetop foliage, the leaves are more kind of vertically oriented around the stem, almost running parallel with the stem, and they're spirally arranged. So that makes a lot more kind of nooks and crannies for fog water to settle and condense. Also, the stomata kind of change their distribution from being on the leaf underside to the leaf top side. And that could be that through the stomata is where the fog absorption is happening, so it makes sense to have your stomata on the top of the leaf surface where fog is going to be settling. So yeah, we'll talk more about that.
If you go back to the previous slide with the two graphs right next to each other for the Sitka spruce and the redwood, on one of these you have, so I'm the biologist, I have no idea what I'm looking at, but you have SMA in
LMA?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a great question. I was just kind of glossing over it, but you caught it. Okay, so so SMA is shoot mass to area ratio, and that has to do with many Cupressaceae species, the leaves are not shed individually. They're kind of more shed in these units, and so it's difficult to study leaf mass to area ratio because the kind of the foliar unit are these shoots. So in a lot of Cupressaceae species like redwood or giant sequoia, they look at shoot mass to area ratio, so just a bunch of leaves on one sprig, versus on something like Sitka spruce, which does shed its leaves individually, it's more meaningful to look at it on a leaf basis rather than a shoot basis. So it's still looking at a mass to area ratio, but it's looking at it at the shoot level in Cupressaceae versus Sitka spruce, which is in Pinaceae, looking at it at the leaf level there.
So it's basically a difference in the type of leaves that it has.
Yeah.
Like each individual green thing is a shoot.
This is like 300 leaves, you know, or something. Each one of these little things is a leaf, and this will be shed as a unit.
Oh.
All right. Oh, okay, Conrad.
You see, as far as morphology from tall leaves to lower leaves, is there a textbook reason for why they're doing that? Do you think that like allows more sunlight to trickle down to the bottom? Is that kind of like where are you going to get to like the textbook reason why it's like that?
The textbook reason, so I might not be understanding totally, but are you talking about like sun leaves versus shade leaves and why they look so different?
Exactly, yeah,
okay, so like, if you had no height gradient, like say you had just potted plants, right, and you grew them in different light levels, so nothing about like self-shading or hydraulics or anything, typically the sun leaves are going to be way more compact, like not as much surface area, because the leaf is the photosynthetic organ, so its job is to capture sunlight energy, and if you're in a really high light environment, you can capture sufficient energy with less surface area. And in low light environments, you need way more surface area to kind of get the job done. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so break time. Let's get started with Act 2, because I'm sure that like the anticipation is just killing you. You can't take it any longer. the mystery of why is there such a weak morphology gradient in Sitka spruce? I mean, if I don't tell you, you probably won't sleep at night. So I left you a short while ago, in case you've forgotten, with this kind of mystery that there's this really weak morphology gradient in tall Sitka spruce. So even though they're over 300 feet tall, we don't see this huge variation in leaf morphology that we see in other tall conifers. So a bit of a head scratcher there, right? And so act two here, local water uptake. So there's this maybe, if we aren't seeing this morphology gradient, and we think that the morphology gradient is driven by light and hydraulics, maybe somehow Sitka spruce is bypassing that gravitational component of water potential. So perhaps, maybe, crazier things have happened, the tree is absorbing a substantial amount of water locally in the crown. So that's kind of what I set out to investigate. So shown here are some pictures from the crown in a Sitka spruce tree. And so a couple things might be popping out to you. One is there's a boatload of epiphytes growing on that branch, right? So I'm not sure what it is about Sitka spruce. Somebody should look into this. But Sitka spruce, and maybe it's the potato chippy bark, maybe it's the bark chemistry, like for whatever reason, it is just loaded with epiphytes. So that's one thing to notice. And then another thing to notice is that if you look closely on some Sitka spruce branches, there are these weird roots growing. So we're talking like 200 feet above the forest floor. You're hanging out and by golly, there's a root in the tree. And so roots, one of their main functions is absorbing water. So it's possible that maybe they're doing something up there. All right. So for this act two of this, considering this possibility of local water uptake, a couple kind of lines of evidence that would make us think this is a plausible idea. So normally plants absorb water, right, from their roots, the water moves up the plant body and then out through the leaves into the atmosphere through the stomata. But some evidence is suggesting that I've been looking at that maybe these Sitka spruce are in fact uptaking local water. So three kind of bullets of evidence. One is this really weak leaf morphology gradient. So LMA, leaf mass to area ratio, it's not really changing that spectacularly with height. The second piece of evidence, which I'll show you in a minute, is that Sitka spruce, when I went out and measured it, it actually has, and I could hardly believe it when I was measuring it, but it actually has more relaxed water potential than you would expect due to gravity. So I'll show you that in a minute, some data about that. And then this has kind of implications. This third bullet point is that, remember with redwood, how the maximum photosynthetic rate, it decreased with height. In Sitka spruce, it is more or less constant. We don't see this drastic decrease in height. So this possible local absorption of water could really be influencing treetop productivity if it's making it such that photosynthesis isn't limited like we see in redwood. All right, so if Sitka spruce is absorbing water somehow in the crown, there's kind of three potential areas or ways that it's absorbing water that I'm setting out to investigate. One is, as one guy asked here in the front about, one is through the leaves. Maybe the leaves are absorbing bog water, right? Again, crazier things have happened. The second option is maybe those adventitious roots. I mean, roots absorb water, right? Maybe those adventitious roots way up yonder in the tree crown, maybe they're absorbing water, some sort of local water input. And then the third idea is maybe somehow they're absorbing water through the bark. Could that even maybe possibly happen? So to the Redwood Experimental Forest I went. So this is a picture from one of the treetops up there. It's a really beautiful forest a little bit north of Klamath, up the 101 about an hour. And it's this kind of cool little pocket of old growth, and you can do some research there. It's an experimental forest for research, a part of Six Rivers National Forest. There I went, and Steve Sillett had already kind of scoped out all the big pumpkin Sitka spruce trees and had them rigged and for climbing and everything, so it's pretty much a turnkey situation for tree climbing. All right, and so the first thing that I measured was, okay, I want to see if possibly they are actually uptaking some sort of local water source, and I was pretty convinced that it had to be through the adventitious roots. So we went out, my husband and I, Nick, and we did a lot of pre-dawn water potential work. So if you remember back to that graph I showed you with water potential and how it decreases linearly with height due to gravity, kind of the weight of pulling water up 300 feet against gravity. Well, at pre-dawn is kind of the most relaxed that water potential can possibly be. During the middle of the day, say at midday, when transpiration is happening, so when water is actively moving through the plant, because water is polar, it's going to adhere to the xylem cells inside the wood, and it's like drag, it's friction. And that frictional component of water potential will further decrease water potential, making it even more negative. So at the pre-dawn is the most relaxed the water potential can possibly be in the absence of transpirational pull. So you wake up ridiculously early. We would leave our house at like 1 and drive to Klamath and climb trees. There were some pretty comic mornings with headlamps being lost, like trying to find the study tree, arguing. Anyway, so you climb up the tree with a headlamp and you take different cuttings from different heights, and then you have the pressure bomb over there on the left waiting down below. And so one person works the bomb, one person climbs, and repels down little baggies of samples and you bomb away. So that pressure bomb is just a way of measuring the water potential of these different sprigs. And this is super exciting, so hold on to your socks, but check out what we found. Okay, and this might not mean that much to you, but I'm gonna explain it to you and then you're gonna be like, holy Toledo. All right, so here we have height across the top, right? So basically from the base of the live crown to the treetop. And then on the vertical axis, we have the water potential, pre-dawn water potential. And so again, more negative is more stressed, like more stressy. And so we see that gravitational potential gradient, that's the red line, that for every meter of height increase, water potential should decrease by 0.01 megapascals. And so in theory, at pre-dawn, again, the most relaxed that the tree could possibly be hydrologically, at pre-dawn, if it was just due to gravity, you would expect these lines, these dots, to be below this red line, basically, or maybe at this red line. But the fact that they're, the vast majority of these data points are all above this gravitational line is strongly suggesting that there's some sort of, that the tree is bypassing that path length, that pathway from the soil all the way up to the crown. So there is likely some sort of local absorption of water happening in these treetops, which is pretty cool. So they found a way maybe to kind of relax their water potential in these tall treetops. Does this make sense? Are there any questions about this? This is kind of an important point.
Is this just for the Sitka spruce?
Yep, this is just for Sitka spruce. So okay. These are Sitka spruce trees at Redwood Experimental Forest. Yep.
So
how does the pressure bomb work? Ooh, okay. I was gonna skip over that, but if somebody wants to know, it's super fun and cool. So when you, and students of mine are like, oh gosh, not the pressure bomb again. But when you cut a sprig from a plant, the water is under tension, and so it recoils back. And so the more tension that the water column was under, the further back a physical distance, the water will snap. And so basically, cut your sprig and then you stick it in the bomb with the cut end sticking out and you pressurize this chamber, and however much pressure it takes to move the water back to the cut surface, pressure and tension are two ends of the same stick, right? So the amount of pressure it takes to push the water back to the cut end is equal to the amount of tension that the water had been in the plant body. So it's really simple and easy to do, and kind of fun. You get to feel a little bit like a mad scientist with safety goggles and everything. So.
So with the water potential gradient, the 0.1 megapascals per meter, is that just with redwoods or is that with other species as well?
It's been shown, it's like with all species. Yeah, it can vary slightly, but. And I'm rounding up, it's actually 0.0098. But so anyway, it can vary slightly with species, but generally you can think of it as about 0.01 per meter. It has to do with kind of the weight of water against gravity.
And so my other question, with redwoods or your uptake, would that change the
So water potential at all?
Yeah, it potentially would. So, yeah.
So is there like a viewing window in that bob where you can see like the water?
No, you use a hand lens. And it's a little bit frightening because you have to put your face right down next to this like pressurized metal chamber. Hand lens. Again, a little bit exciting. It is fun. Okay, so we're good with this figure.
Oh. Is that many different trees?
This is based on three different trees.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Water potential is, like explaining it in detail is a little bit beyond this talk, but you could think of it as kind of water stress, like the water status of the plant. So more negative numbers are more stressed, and more, numbers closer to zero are more relaxed. Okay. Yeah.
What's the tallest tree
you've here for the Sitka spruce? Oh, and well, I think like 111 meters. Yeah. Okay. Okay. All right. So here we go. Foliar absorption of water. So this is one possible way that one of these possible local uptake places. So this has been really well studied down at UC Berkeley. Todd Dawson's lab has done a lot of work using stable isotopes to look at foliar absorption of water. And so this is one of my favorite papers, this Burgess and Dawson, that looked at foliar uptake of fog water and how it can affect plant water status. And so here's this cool figure, and we have on the vertical axis percent fog water uptake, and then on the x-axis these different kind of treatments that they did. And what's super cool is we've got old leaves that are well watered. They could uptake about 7% of their leaf water content was could be fog derived. And these young leaves that were well watered, and then old leaves water stressed, and young leaves water stressed, they had less water absorption than these old well watered leaves. And so there's two kind of key important facts about this figure. Why the old leaves that were well watered could absorb more water. So the first component is the difference between the old and the young. So old versus young. The old leaves, their epidermis and their cuticle is more cracky. They're older, they've been around longer, the UV light kind of degrades the waxy hydrophobic cuticle, and so it's leakier, so fog water might be able to absorb through that cracked cuticle more. And then also in the old leaves, I'll save this actually. There's one more thing about the old leaves, but I'm going to save that till the next slide. And then the fact that well-watered versus water-stressed old leaves, that has to do with the stomata. So in the stressed leaves, the stomata are closed, and in the well-watered leaves, the stomata are open. So strongly suggesting that the water is coming in through the stomatal pores, because the water-stressed plants weren't really uptaking fog water as effectively in this experiment. And so the other component about old leaves that maybe possibly allows them to uptake more fog water compared to the young leaves, and this is pretty cool, is they found when they looked at electron microscopy images that there were a number of hyphae coming out of the stomatal pores. So redwood has a lot of endophytic fungi, these various fungal species that live inside the leaves. And they caught, like on some of their microscopy work, these hyphae kind of extending out through the pores, possibly acting like little antennae, sort of wicking water into the leaf through the stomatal pores. So in young leaves, they haven't yet kind of gotten all of these endophytic fungi. They haven't kind of established these endophytic fungal communities. So it's possible that in Sitka spruce, it's been shown in redwood and coast redwood that coast redwood can absorb fog water. So it's possible that that might be what's going on with Sitka spruce, explaining those relaxed water potential values. And so, kind of from this same paper, this is actually showing sap flow. So with sap flow is you put these two like probes in the sapwood of the tree, and using a temperature gradient between a heated probe and an unheated probe, you can tell how fast water is moving in the sapwood. It's pretty cool. And basically what they found in some of their redwoods was that there was reverse sap flow at different times of the day. So again, kind of strongly suggesting that there was some foliar absorption of water happening that was affecting all the way down, like the flow of water in the tree, all the way down to the stem at 1 meter. So pretty cool work. Again, this was from UC Berkeley, Todd Dawson's lab. Pretty strong evidence that redwood is in fact capable and does absorb fog water through its leaves. Okay, so highly likely that this could also be happening with Sitka spruce. And it turns out one of Todd's grad students, Emily Burns Lynn, she's now the director of science for Save the Redwoods League, she did a bunch of cool work looking at using stable isotopes in water to look at fog water absorption. It turns out redwood isn't like the only one that can do this. She looked at 10 different species in the redwood forest, and all of them were capable of foliar absorption of fog water. Sword fern, shown here, being kind of the champion. So Polystichum unitum on the far left, percent increase in leaf water content due to fog could be up to 12%. And then here's a number of other species that she looked at in the redwood forest ecosystem, and they were all, you know, showed various capabilities of foliar absorption of fog water. So pretty cool. She didn't, however, look at Sitka spruce. So again, pretty likely that this is also occurring in Sitka spruce, hence those relaxed water potential values. Okay, the second possibility, so if Sitka spruce is absorbing some local crown water sources, we've got, probably foliar absorption of fog water through the leaves, maybe through the stromal pores, maybe through a leaky endodermis, who knows. The second possibility is this idea of the adventitious roots. Like, what are these adventitious roots doing way up there, right, if they're not absorbing water? And so the adventitious roots, they can be pretty extensive here at the southern portion of the Sitka spruce range. They're not that extensive, but Steve was telling tall tales of up on the Olympic Peninsula having to use a crowbar to wrap a D-tape around a branch to get a diameter measurement on the branch because it was so covered in adventitious roots. In wetter areas like the Olympic Peninsula, apparently there are even more adventitious roots being produced. But these adventitious roots, they grow underneath these huge kind of epiphyte mats. So there's been a lot of work done by Nalini Nadkarni that's looked at kind of the nutritional capacity, like how these adventitious roots can increase post-tree nutrition, so the absorption of micronutrients and things like that through these adventitious roots, but nobody's really looked at how/if these adventitious roots are uptaking water in the crown. So using stable isotope analyses, it's very possible to try to tease this out. So maybe take some adventitious roots in situ in the tree and stick them in tubs of isotopically labeled water, and then sample downstream to see if you can detect that label. So maybe, we'll see. So this is another possibility of something that's happening up in these crowns that you might not have been on your radar.
Lucy, a question. Was that branch cleared of the moss?
No, that was cleared take a diameter measurement of the branch.
Yeah, so it was cleared, yeah.
It was for science.
Yeah. That's all right. Looks pretty gnarly. Looks gnarly. Yeah.
So then my third kind of possible idea about what's going on, like why are we seeing this relaxed water potential in Sitka spruce crowns in like a non-decreasing photosynthetic capacity relative to redwood in these crowns, is that maybe they're absorbing water through the bark. So we think of bark as being this hydrophobic thing, right, that's supposed to like deter water less, but this paper just came out and kind of rocked my world in 2016 that showed that bark water in redwood was happening. So here were some branches. This was this guy, Mason Earls, out of UC Davis. He was a postdoc. And he showed, here's a picture showing on the left, in purplish is the embolized area. So this branch was 48% embolized, so air bubbles in the xylem conduits. And then on the right picture, after soaking the branch for 16 hours and then re-imaging it, only 43% of the area was embolized. So there was this change in the embolized area. Possibly he had sealed the cut ends of the branches And so the only way that water could possibly be getting in there was through the bark. And so they think, they're proposing in this paper anyway, that the water transfer is happening through the symplastic pathway. So from the bark getting in through, basically traveling through the living pathway through the protoplasm of cells, through plasmodesmata. Anyway, kind of interesting, and this could also possibly be happening with Sitka spruce. Sitka spruce, if you're familiar with the species at all, has a really thin bark. Redwood has very thick bark relative to Sitka spruce, so if redwood can absorb water through its bark, it's highly likely that this could also be happening with Sitka spruce. Okay. So that brings me to Act 3, but do we need a beer break, or we could forge ahead? It was going to be talking, I'm saying that these epiphyte communities in Sitka spruce, I'm saying Sitka spruce might have be the champion of kind of crown local water sources, and one of the reasons that this might be the case is because of the rich, dense epiphyte communities that exist up in the crown. So lichens and bryos and ferns, oh my. So there are a lot of things growing in Sitka spruce, and so these are huge like water sources in the crown. So there we're finding like salamanders. In some of these trees there's like 60 salamanders, and these are animals that don't have lungs. Like they breathe through their skin. You know, it has to stay wet. So they're living in these epiphyte mats that in theory are staying wet all year long to support these like salamander communities. And these mats hold a lot of water. So the bark is in theory kind of saturated with water underneath those mats all the time. And there's adventitious roots growing underneath these mats. So I think that these epiphyte communities may be really important to host tree physiology. So traditionally epiphytes, which I should explain that, an epiphyte is just a plant growing on another plant. So these epiphytes traditionally have been thought of as commensal. So meaning that like the epiphyte is benefiting from this interspecific interaction, the epiphyte is gaining more place to live, increased habitat, but the host tree isn't being harmed and it's not benefiting from the interaction. But I'm thinking that these interactions might actually be a lot more mutualistic than we think. Like, yeah, the epiphytes are getting expanded turf by living in the trees, but I think that the epiphytes are actually influencing host tree physiology. By serving as kind of a water reservoir. So because of the importance of these epiphyte communities, I thought I'd spend a little bit of time, and because they're so cool, kind of sharing with you about them, because I think this is a group of plants that are often overlooked and underappreciated. And they're really beautiful. So there was one paper that came out by Billy Ellison and Steve Sillett that looked at, it was in 2003, that looked at epiphyte diversity in Sitka spruce trees in Prairie Creek Redwoods State Park. And you can see they found over 90 species of epiphytes growing in these trees, which is pretty remarkable biodiversity. So they had 5 study trees in Prairie Creek. And you can see here from this figure, I'm not gonna kind of go over it crazily, but here's on the x-axis are percent cover. And then on the vertical axes are height in the tree. So picture this like the tree, like the crown. And then there's these different kind of categories of epiphytes. So going from the top left across, you have fruticose chlorolichens, foliose chlorolichens, cladonia species, crestose lichens, cyanolichens, mosses, liverworts, and ferns. So just to show there's a lot of kind of huge diversity that's occurring in these epiphyte communities on Sitka spruce. So a lot of those terms may have been total Greek to you, so I'm going to kind of introduce now what even are these things. Like I'm like chlorolichen, fruticose lichen, you're probably not understanding that at all. So here we go. So the first thing, and I like talking about this stuff, so I'm gonna try to rein it in, but basically a lichen, it's pretty awesome, and again, I feel like underappreciated how remarkable it is. So it's this mutualistic kind of symbiotic relationship between a fungus and some sort of photosynthetic partner. So the fungus, the mycobiont, makes up the bulk of the lichen thallus, and then you have this photobiont, this photosynthetic partner. And so the photobiont, it can either be a green algae, or it can be a cyanobacterium. Or you could have two photobionts in one lichen thallus. The mycobiont, the fungal partner, it was traditionally thought to be fungi from Ascomycota, but just in 2016, a paper came out in Science that found Basidiomycota yeasts inside the Ascomycota kind of mycelial cortex. So kind of crazy. I'll get more to that in a moment. You might not be as shocked as you will be in a few minutes here. But so this is kind of a cross-section of a lichen, again, mostly fungal material, and then you have on this one this kind of green algal layer. So the fungus is getting sugars from the photobiont, and the photobiont is getting range expansion. So a green algae is living terrestrially, or a cyanobacterium is living terrestrially. All right. So you can have, depending on who the photobiont is, you can have a chlorolichen, shown on the left there, or you can have a cyanolichen, shown on the right here. And so I did bring a bunch of these kind of things to pass around. I'll get to them in 1 minute, so you guys can check them out up close and personal. So you can, the lichen is a fungus plus some sort of photosynthetic partner, and when the fungus is happy, it wants to reproduce sexually, so it'll make these little mushrooms, which are really cute. They're called apothecia in lichens, but they're really adorable. So you'll see those. Yes, you can have a chlorolichen or a cyanolichen, depending on who the photosynthetic partner is. And the cyanolichens are extra special because cyanobacteria fix nitrogen. So this can be a really nice kind of ecosystem service that the cyanolichens are fixing nitrogen, so increasing nitrogen availability to the trees. And so within lichens, you can have a lot of different kind of morphologies. So the first one I thought I'd start with was these crust lichens, these crustose lichens, and I'll pass them around. This one, Ochrolegia, is all over the spruce trees. You should check it out. It has these big orange pumpkin apothecia on it. It's really cool. These apothecia, again, that's the fungal partner making a sexual fruiting body. And then you can also have fruticose lichens, like usnea. A lot of people call it old man's beard. Usnea is all around. And so I brought some of that. You can check it out. I also threw in kind of a coral lichen in there, so check it out. And then you can have these foliose lichens, which look like kind of like lettuce almost. They're pretty yummy looking. So this one is Lobaria. It's around a lot. There's kind of two species around here, Lobaria oregana and Lobaria pulmonaria. And these ones are just kind of wild. So you have here, in this picture here, you have, it's a chlorolichen mostly, so its photobiont is mostly a green algae, but then you can see those weird kind of wrinkles, those ridges in it. Those are where the cyanobacterial photobiont live. So it has two photobionts, so it's a tripartite lichen, and this is actually quite sinful, because it's crossing kingdom lines, which you might not like fully appreciate, but I mean, in one thallus, you have a green algae, a cyanobacterium, and a fungus, and possibly even two fungal like phyla represented. So it's pretty wild. Yeah, you'll never look the same at lichens. Anyway, so yeah, children here. That's right. So I brought some cyanolichen that I'll pass around, and it has some really nice kind of orange apothecia on them. They look kind of like finger-like projections. So this is some Peltigera, and I also brought some Lobaria in to show you guys, and there's some Hypogymnia thrown in here too. So you can pass these around, check them out. Alright. And then our next kind of group of plants that we find up here are these leafy liverworts, which I'm sure 99 99.9% of you out there just look at and think are mosses. But there's actually this whole other group of plants called the liverworts, which are very underappreciated and overlooked. And so the deal with the liverworts is their leaves are kind of arranged more bilaterally along the stem, and on the underside they have these little underleaves. So I brought in some porella to kind of show you guys. Realizing maybe I should switch it up, go over here. So there's some chlorella there. Again, you probably have seen leafy liverworts abundantly, but just always thought that they were a moss. So this may transform how you see the forest. And so these are all, so far, what I've been talking about, like the leafy liverworts, and then here, the mosses. These are non-vascular plants, so they don't have xylem and phloem. They're pretty primitive. So the difference between the mosses and the leafy liverworts, the mosses have a costa, or kind of in quotes, a vein. It's not a real vascular tissue, but they have this kind of costa midrib in a lot of their leaves. And the leaves are more kind of spirally arranged around the stem rather than bilaterally arranged around the stem, like we saw in the leafy liverworts. So you got mosses. Oh yeah, and I have some mosses to pass around. So on the mosses, so with these non-vascular plants, another thing just to wow you and kind of make you fall in love with them is that the gametophyte is the dominant life phase, so the haploid phase of the bryophyte is kind of dominant. So on some of these mosses, you can see you can see the sporophyte on some of these that's kind of doing its thing. So you can check that out. And now getting into some of the higher plants, like the vascular plants that are occurring epiphytically in the Sitka spruce, we've got selaginella, or sometimes called spike moss. And this one is REF, the Redwood Experimental Forest, is the southernmost extension of selaginella growing as an epiphyte. So if you go north from REF, you'll find selaginella growing as an epiphyte, and it makes these beautiful kind of curtains as it hangs down from branches. So it's really cool, but it is considered kind of a primitive fern, so it does have xylem and phloem kind of vascular tissue. And then finally we've got the licorice and the leather fern. So these are both polypodium, and the licorice fern is deciduous. It's summer deciduous. It's kind of cool. So it actually dries up in the summer, and they're both rhizotomous, so they grow from a rhizome, and the fronds of the licorice fern will die in the summer. So I'll pass that around. So these are more kind of advanced evolutionarily plants. They have spores for seeds, so they're still before the seed evolved, but they do have vascular tissue. So there's a lot of these growing on the trees. And then we've got the leather fern, which is, the leather fern is kind of the evergreen cousin of the licorice fern. Again, grows rhizotomously, so you'll see it kind of growing along a branch with the rhizome growing under like a big moss mat. And so, for continuing research, one thing I wanted to say is that for all of these epiphytes, when we've so far only been working doing an epiphyte inventory in one Sitka spruce, it's very time consuming, and Wade Polda has been kind of leading that effort, but in one tree so far we've found 53 species, so that's just like in one tree, 53 epiphyte species, and we're not even done. Like, a lot of the IDs are just to genus, you know, we don't even have it to species. So they're extremely rich and diverse communities up in these old growth Sitka spruce trees. I didn't mention it. Sitka spruce grows really quickly, and these trees are about 300 years old. So they grow really fast. So let's see here. So continuing research, kind of what I'm still, so I've told you kind of what I'm up to. And this is what I'm continuing to do. So starting next year, I have a grad student who's going to be looking at using stable isotope analyses to actually investigate these three crown water sources. So looking at, is Sitka spruce absorbing fog water? Is Sitka spruce absorbing water via the adventitious roots? And is Sitka spruce absorbing water through the bark? So that'll be kind of one master's student. And then I'm pretty curious if you think about it, kind of hear me out with this thought. It seems to me that, so we have these ferns that are growing on these epiphyte mats, and particularly the licorice fern is a summer deciduous fern that dries up in the summer. So it seems to me that possibly the host tree could be helping the fern communities in the tree, if in the summer, the host tree has access to groundwater and it's summer and the epiphyte mats maybe have dried out due to the dry season, no precipitation inputs, it seems to me that water could actually leave, ground-derived water from the root system, could actually leave the host tree through the adventitious roots down a water potential gradient into the drying moss mats, and possibly prolong kind of fern productivity into the growing season. Or maybe on some branches with adventitious roots, those ferns don't die. Those licorice ferns don't pinch off in the summer. Anyway, I'd like to use stable isotopes to kind of investigate that further. And then Wade is gonna be taking over and kind of continuing this epiphyte diversity study. So lots of stuff going on with Sitka Spruce, and they're super cool, so appreciate them. And I think that's all I had to say. And I've passed out all my props. So thanks for your attention, and I can take some questions if you have any.